Hi everybody, and welcome to our Wednesday's Facebook Live at 12:30 Eastern Standard Time. I'm glad you joined us today, and I hope you'll make some comments in the comments as we go here. But the first thing I'd like to ask you is, as you come in, go ahead and say hello in the chat below and let us know that you are here and tell us where you're watching from. We love to see where everybody comes in from around the world. So we encourage you to go ahead and do that. Last week we were working on this Qube Ottoman project, if you remember, and I had showed you the picture of the completed cube that I did prior to making the second cube. And just so that you could kind of see it, I wanted two cubes for myself, so this one is being made out of a different sari as the first one. And if you remember, the first one was made out of a recycled sari that was more of a patchwork, and this one's a little bit less of a patchwork effect, although it's going to be patchworky sort of when I'm done with it, because of the way I've cut things out here. But again, as you come in, go ahead and say hello. We also ask that you hit the share button right there in the Facebook feed. You'll see a place where you can share this live event, and we ask you to please do that. It helps us get the word out for Kim's Upholstery, and I know several of you shared it last week, and we appreciate that, and thank you very much. So go ahead, hit that share now, and then come on right back. We're not going anywhere. You won't miss anything. So go ahead and do that now, if you would, and I'm going to get my fabric pieces out here. If you remember last week, we did the padding on the cube. We put on the dacron. We've got the foam that we used on the top. The frame was built out of plywood. And then we also planned our cuts for the fabric. I talked about the sizes and everything and how I cut these out. So I got all my pieces cut out. And then I pinned them together just to kind of show you how it was all going to flow. And also so that when I go to the sewing machine, I'm not fumbling around with pieces and trying to remember what goes where. I've got them kind of temporarily pinned together. But as I was setting up for today, this was the side that I originally had planned to have the Qube Ottoman out of, and you wouldn't see these navy blue pieces at the bottom because they'd be what goes underneath the frame and are attached to the actual plywood. But as I was getting everything out today, as Kim has a habit of doing, I looked at it and went, maybe I want to change the order of those. So let me flip it over and show you why I was thinking that. Because you know, if you watched last week, that I really loved this floral part that was in this sari, and there wasn't enough of it to make the whole cube out of it. But as I am looking at the back sides of these, I've got these two that are partial. This has got part of this kind of a print, and then it's got part of this green print. And then this other one is part of this print, and then it is part of that print. So I'm thinking I may mix these up. So let me play around with these for a second and just see if I like the flow moving things around, because I like to mix it up. Who doesn't? It's fun. It's fabric, right? It's color. So let me see. I like this one. So I'm just going to unpin them. Here we go, dropping my pins. I'll set them up here. That way I'll know right where they are. So as you come in, I said, you know, mentioned to you to go ahead and say hello and let us know what you're working on. We love seeing pictures of people's projects, and a lot of our members have been posting some really great pictures in the members group that we have of the work they've been doing. I don't know if she's here yet this morning or this afternoon, but Bonnie Javit just posted a really great picture of a channelback chair. It was her very first one. She did a fabulous job, and she was so excited with the outcome, and she's got another one to do, I think she said.
See if you can find it in there for me. Oh. I don't know if I got a problem or...
So we're just checking to make sure that we are live, because it seems like we can't find ourselves. So let me flow through here and see if I can see it. If you are out there seeing us live, post a comment and maybe that will make it show back up in our feed. You just never know with technology what's going to happen. I do not see it on your cell phone, Bill. Let me check on mine. So bear with us if you are there. We're just trying to make sure that we are in fact here. I know we are because Crystal shared our video. So Crystal is seeing us. Thank you, Crystal Younger. Let me open it up. It takes a little bit. You know how that goes with the technology. And of course my phone wants to be really slow just because I want it to work fast. Isn't that true though? When you need something to happen, like right now, it just does not want to. And I am not seeing it on mine either, Bill.
Well, you're live on YouTube.
Well, I guess we're live on YouTube, but we seem to be struggling with Facebook. So if you can see us, I'm just going to keep going and hope that you can. Will we figure out what's happening at our end? Because we know those of you on YouTube can see us. Yeah, it is not coming up on my phone. So I'm not quite sure. You know what, Bill? Let me go check on my personal page because one time it put it there. So let's go check. And that's exactly where it is. It's on Kim Shagnon instead of on Kim's Upholstery. So we are live, Bill. We're just not in the right place today. So I'm going to go ahead and hit share and share this onto our page to get it over there, or we may decide to go out and come back in. I don't know what Bill will decide here in a second. But I'm glad you saw us on my Facebook page, but that is not where we intended to go live. And my phone is not letting me. Yeah, it's not letting me post it to the page, Bill. Oh, wait, there it goes. I can post the live link to our Facebook page. So you want me to do that, or do you want to shut off and come back in? It's on Kimberly Shagnon. It's not on Kim's Upholstery.
I understand that, but if you post it there, it just stays there, right?
It should, yes.
I don't know if I can change that midstream or not.
He's going to see if he can fix this, and if for some reason we lose you, we will come back on the Kim's Upholstery Facebook page. But bear with us. We are trying to figure this out. Every once in a while, technology takes a twist, and you just don't know what's going to happen.
I don't. This is awful.
Well, why don't we... It's probably easier if we just go off camera for a minute, and then we'll come back live as soon as we get it reset up, if you want.
20 minutes.
Oh, it takes that long? Okay. I guess we don't want to do that.
Head on over to Facebook. I mean, over to YouTube.
So... I'm going to put this on our page, though. So thank you for bearing with us here. All right, so I have posted it to the Kim's Upholstery page, so hopefully people that are waiting for us there will come on over. So there we go. All right, so back to business. And I will refresh Bill's phone to see if it did, in fact, post it over there. Getting everything straight, you have those days, you know? And it's just taking me a minute to refresh all of this. I'm still not seeing it on our page. Let me see if I go into activity. Technology is fun, huh? Not. Okay, sorry, I'm not talking to you. I'm trying to figure this out. I can't really tell, Bill. You're going to have to play with this part. Let me just give him his phone and I'll be right back here.
You're talking to YouTube.
Okay, so I am back. So I think we're live on the Kim's Upholstery or Kim's personal page on Facebook, and we're live on YouTube, but I have shared it on the Kim's Upholstery page, so hopefully you can come in over there for those of you that were sitting there waiting for us because it posted in the wrong place today. But as I mentioned before, go ahead and share this event as we finally get it underway and let us know that you're watching and say hello and where you are from and let us know if you're doing an upholstery project because we'd love to know what you're working on as well.
Use your phone to find the questions and stuff.
Yeah, so I'm going to need to use my phone to find questions. This is true because this way Bill will not be able to see them. Let's see. So give me a second just to refresh my phone again so it's in the right place. Looks like there is a comment somewhere. But my thought process was to change these fabrics around because I really like this floral part. So somebody's asking if we're live today. We are, but we're not where you're looking. So my thought process was to change it around because this was my favorite fabric out of this whole sari. So I was kind of like trying to figure out how to get it in there without having too much of it. So let me kind of look at these one more time. And I know I did this last week, but like I said, I do change my mind periodically. So if we did that and that, and that and that, do I like that? Let me shift my cube out of the way. See, if we do, then that's going to be attached to that over there. So many things to take into account, right? It's like I don't want too heavy on the pink. I don't want too heavy on the green. I think I'm going back to what I originally went with because I just don't think this is going to work. If we do it this way, then we've got too much of the floral, not enough of the other patterns. So I think I'm going to go right side up. Leaves grow up. Remember that, you know. We did have an employee worked for us once, and she was upholstering a chair for me, and we had a vine print, and she did the deck perfect. One inside arm was great, and then I left the room and went somewhere else, and I came back when she was on the inside back, and she had done the second arm with the vine going down, so we had to take it all off and redo it. So you always want to pay attention to the up direction of your fabric when you're working on anything, because it can very easily get misconstrued on you. Then this would be green. Okay. I think I'm going to go like that. So that'll give me, I know you can't see it sitting there, but it'll give me a little bit of that floral pattern on one side, but it kind of mimics this side because it's got part of this design as well as a little bit of that. So I think that's what I'm going to go with. So let me go ahead and get this pinned back together. Put them right sides together. Maybe I can hold it up and show you once I get some pins in here. But I'm just pinning them just to anchor them in place while I get to the sewing machine. I don't really need the pins to be sewing. If you do need pins in your project to sew, by all means, go right ahead and do that. I've been sewing since I was about 9 years old, so I've gotten to a point where I very rarely use pins, except for slipcovers. Slipcovers, you always use pins. So let me check and see if we've got any questions on there. Let me open it up here. Okay, where'd you go? There we are. Okay, so hello, Annette. She says she can see us on Facebook. Thank you. Aisha says hello. Whoops, I have got to mute myself because you don't need to hear that echo. Amy Otson, hello, Amy. Amy, you put out something the other day that I was looking at that was really cool. Oh, I know, it was those painted pillows you did with the animal faces. I loved that. That was so cool. I would love some fabric done like that to upholster on something. Amy is in Minnesota. We've got Crystal. Hello, Crystal from Missouri. And Crystal will be hosting a workshop for me in July in Missouri. So we are going to get that out there pretty soon for people to start signing up. Let's see, Michelle Brott-Williams is here. Scott is Robbins is here. Hello. Tammy Peridoski is here. Hello. And Facebook says, congratulations. This is your 25th broadcast. Woohoo! I didn't even know that. And there's four other people that are here that I can't see you. So if you're out there and I didn't mention your name, it's because I can't see that you're here. But hello to all of you and thanks for joining us. Okay, and go ahead and hit that share button. I know Crystal shared it already for us and we appreciate that. So let me go ahead and add some more pins. Now this one to this one. And these recycled saris are great. I think I had mentioned last week that I picked them up at the Brimfield Flea Market. And I have since found them online and they're very inexpensive. And they're just, you know, they've got so many beautiful colors that they'd be great for just throw pillows in a room even. All right, so let me see if I can finagle holding this for you. And it's just got a few pins, so it's not going to be easy to hold the whole thing up. But so you can see that I've kind of staggered the more pink to the more green squares. And then when you go over here, and if I plan this right, this one's green and this one's pink. So when they're attached, the pattern will continue. But I did love those little daisy prints. Where are they? Right there, that I wanted to get in here. So that's what I was going for. And that's the top. So the top is just all those kind of daisy sort of prints. And I've got all my supplies here. We've got the cube padded. So all we need to do is sew this baby together and then upholster it to the frame. And I've got everything ready to go for when we get away from the sewing machine. So let me package this up and hop on over to the sewing machine and we can chat some more. Okay, my neat little pile and my top square. So let me just check here and see if anybody else is asking questions. And that is the other reason why we do this, is we encourage you to go ahead and ask your upholstery related questions, because that's what we love to do, is answer and help everybody. Hello, Kippy Kim O'Hearn from Florida. I'm headed your way in the end of this month. Not quite close to you though, I'm going to Sarasota. And hello, Lori and Stacy Faulkner, and it says three others, but I can't see who you are. So hello to all of you. And I don't see any questions yet, but we encourage you to go ahead and ask those questions. Just post them right there in the comments, and I try to answer them as we go. And then some of them, if I miss some of your questions during the broadcast, we do go back afterwards and try to fill in and answer what we missed during the live. So we do encourage you to go ahead and ask any questions that you might have upholstery or soft home furnishings related. So I've got just a neutral green thread in here because this fabric's got so many colors in it that it worked. So let's go ahead and get it under here. Oops, it helps if you turn your sewing machine on. I like my other Juki, my light is hitched up to my sewing machine, the one with the servo motor. So when I turn it on, the light comes on, and that's how I know it's on because with the servos, you don't hear it. But I'm using a different machine today, and I forgot that it wasn't on. In this one, you can hear. So I'm using a Juki walking foot sewing machine. This is the DNU241H. The one I typically use is my DNU1541S. They both work the same. The other one is a servo motor, and for some reason, the other one is a little bit better on Sunbrella fabrics than this one is. But other than that, they're pretty much the same machine. Now, when I do anything with upholstery related, and this is different for a lot of you that are in the drapery world and not in the upholstery end of the soft home furnishings, I use a bonded nylon thread. This is a 69 bonded nylon thread, so it's quite heavy compared to what you use in the drapery world. And I have to tell you a funny story. It wasn't so funny for the person it happened to, but it's funny afterwards. Not laughing at her expense or anything, but it's one of those things. She was doing a Ottoman project for a client, and she's one of our members, and she was using the regular drapery weight thread, and she did a pillow top Ottoman. So I don't know if you know what that is, but I'll try to describe it so that you understand. It's a cushion that sits on top of an Ottoman. It's actually upholstered with it, but it looks like a separate cushion, so you can get your hands in between the cushion and the frame of the Ottoman. So she sewed the whole components together using her drapery weight threads, delivered it off to the client, and within, I forget, it was a very short time span, she got a call that everything was coming unsewn, that it was just falling apart, the cushion was coming off and coming apart. So that's a good lesson to learn or it's not so fun to learn, but it is a good lesson to learn, and a reason why I always stress to my members is to use the 69 bonded nylon thread. When you're doing anything upholstery related, and I would say even in the drapery world, when you're doing cushions for clients and window seats, it's something to consider too, is you want a thread that you can't tear by hand. Because cushions, as you know, when people sit on them, they work them and they end up tearing stuff. So just something to keep in mind and knowledge to have, is to use a heavier duty thread for things that are going to get a lot of use. Actually, let me turn that stitch down a little bit. I had it set for working on leather the other day, so I had a little bit of a wide stitch on here, which I don't want. I typically use my stitch length between 4 and 5 millimeters on the machine. Whoops, and my needle came unthreaded. Let me go ahead and re-thread that. And sewing cushions, and this is kind of like a cushion without a bottom, when you're sewing it, can be one of the most difficult things to sew. And I get a lot of questions about cushion fabrication. And we have some different tutorials on it, but you still, even, you know, after years of sewing, you still, some people will have troubles with cushions, and it really takes understanding what your fabric, how your fabric behaves, because every fabric is different. As I know many of you know that. Like a chenille, for example, will behave much differently than the fabric that I'm working on right now. You know, this fabric is not stretching, it's not warping, but you, if you're working with some sort of a chenille, you may get that racking of a cushion if you're not sewing it in the proper order. So this little cube is kind of like a big cushion, only it's hard. Now these would be great in a situation if you have a, you know, a space where you oftentimes entertain and you need more seating but you don't have room for big chairs. You could have these kind of cubes, you know, stuck in the corner somewhere or shoved under a side table or something, and then just pull them out for seating when you needed it. You could also have them grouped together and working as a coffee table in a room and still be able to pull them out as extra seating. Let's see, which ones did I sew those to? Okay. So they really come in handy. And they're fun too. We did a couple for a client not too long ago, and I was like, you know what? I want some of those. Bill hates it when I say those words, when it's like, hon, I've got an idea. He's like, oh, here she goes again. And he knows that means he's going to have to build me something. So therefore, I now have two cubes. Or I will have two cubes when this one's done. Speaking of cubes, can I show them what I did with the one we already have, Bill? Can we do that now? So you saw me with the finished cube, and if you'd look, as I pull my, wait for him to get the camera, I pull my butt out here, I have actually put wheels on this cube so that I can use it at my sewing machine. And it is a perfect height with the height of the finished ottoman and then the extra couple of inches for the wheels. It just ended up being a perfect height at the sewing machine, and I could slide it between sewing machines, which is really cool. So I'm loving my little cube. Let me scoot back. I hooked on the rug behind me. There we go. But so I've already put my first cube to use. So I have two of the office style chairs, but I just never find they're at the right height, and they're always repositioning things. And this cube has really been comfortable to sew at. And you could adjust the heights, you know, based on your needs to sew at your sewing machine. Okay, so we now have the four, whoops, hooked myself with a pin. We have the four sides sewn together and stuck under the sewing machine. So here you can see I have sewn that side seam on each of the pieces. So now what I need to do is bring these last two edges together and go ahead and sew them. And then I'll have one big piece. And hopefully when it's done, I like the colors that I put in. Hey, Michelle. Michelle says she has one in her closet for putting on her shoes. Hey, that's a great idea. I like that idea. Rosemary said, where did you get your 69 bonded thread? My 69 bonded thread came from Albany Foam and Supply. I think Sailrite carries it as well. I have seen people say that they have gotten it from Wawak. I haven't actually seen it myself in Wawak, but Albany is where I order all my stuff from. So that's where mine came from. So, in your closet to put your shoes on. I like that idea. I just love the fact that you can slide them out of the way and then pull them back into the room when you need them. And I think if I had brought, if I brought them home, my kittens would have a ball with them. Because right now they're like at that young phase where they're like into everything and running all over the place. It's like having kids again. But it's fun. All right, so here you can see I have my four sides sewn together and I'm in one big circle here. So now what we need to do is sew the top. And I have marked with a pin right there so that I wouldn't get confused as the top with the top and the bottom. Because I think I mentioned to you before that this bottom has this accent of navy blue on here, which I don't want on my finished cube. So that will get stapled underneath the frame. So hello, Raquel. Greetings from New York, she says. I love the color combinations of the fabrics. Thanks. I know, I love all the bright colors. I am definitely a color girl. I'm not a you know, black and white or gray or neutrals. No. In fact, I saw somewhere recently that this year's color is going to be shades of green, which isn't a bad thing. So what I'm going to do with this is I'm going to get some pins in the top here, and this is so that if it stretches or moves on me while I'm sewing, I will know it before I get all the way done with four sides if my spacing shifts. So I'm just going to get a pin at each corner here just to kind of give me a reference point so I know where I want everything to land. And I work around this corner. Get a pin over here, and that's landing right. Perfect. So far, so good. My measurements are accurate. And that's one thing when you're doing any of these projects is if your measurements are off, you're just causing yourself a nightmare. It's all in the measuring and making your cuts proper and then keeping a consistent seam allowance. I was talking to someone just recently that was having an issue with the cushion, and I think it ended up being that it was an inconsistent seam allowance. And it's so easy when you're sitting at the sewing machine sewing to get, you know, thinking about something else, or the phone rings and you lose track of the fabric underneath or something, and then you end up not having a consistent finish because of your inconsistent seam allowances. So that's huge when you're sewing. It's the same in garment making. If you're making clothes, they don't fit right if they're not seamed right. I never enjoyed garment making. I did take a tailoring class when I was in my, I forget, my early 20s, I think. And I enjoyed the process of the tailoring, but I just didn't enjoy the clothing aspect of it for some reason. It was fun for your kids. When your kids were little, making little dresses for the girls or shorts for my son, that kind of stuff was fun, but my mother actually liked to sew clothes. She actually sewed my wedding dress and all my bridesmaids' dresses. And then, but yet when I was in school and she wanted to sew my dresses when I was in high school and stuff, I was like, yeah, not really, Mom. But she did do a beautiful job. I wish I had let her do more of that. All right, so I have my corners all lined up so that as I'm sewing, I know if anything shifts off. So now we will, which I, from doing the first one, I know this sari fabric doesn't move at all. It's really nice to sew with. And it's not just a single sari, they're actually layered together. I know you really can't see this on camera, but there's three layers of fabric that they've hand stitched together to make these. They were actually throws made out of recycled saris. Okay. Get myself in position and do my lock stitch. Go ahead and get that pin out of my way, because you know how much fun it is if you sew over a pin. Not. You break needles, you mess up your timing. And we all learn the hard way, don't we, when it comes to sewing? It's like, going over one pin won't be that bad. Crunch. There you go. Now your machine's in the shop. I think my best sewing machine story, and Bill will probably be chuckling behind the screen, that I'm telling this, is I had a Viking home domestic sewing machine, and it was a fairly expensive machine at the time, not compared to these, but, and it was, had an electronic board or computerized board, and it needed the light bulb changed, and you know exactly where I'm going with this, don't you? So the light bulb died, and I got a cheap light bulb to put back in the machine and did my thing, changed the light bulb, and all of a sudden it went and I hadn't unplugged the sewing machine and it blew the whole circuit board. So that was like a $120 light bulb fix. So all those things that you learn by doing them the wrong way the first time. All right. Now getting my corners pivoted so that I've got nice square points in the end of my construction here. And for those of you, I know some of you out there watching, hello, Mariano. You are here from Argentina. Hey, thanks for joining us. It's so much fun to see where people come from. So yeah, so I know some of our members have probably already watched this video for this Ottoman because it is in the membership site. And I'm excited to see when some of you do your cubes. I know one person has posted some cubes that she had done before we did this for a client in the group. And I mean, these are just like such nice little accent pieces too. So you can either make them very neutral and make them blend with the room, or you can do something really fun and make them pop. Hello, Mary from Fort Lauderdale, Florida. Is it still warm down there? We're going to be in Florida the end of the month, and I'm hoping it's warm. Somebody told me it was getting chilly down there. Although chilly for you guys and chilly for us is two different things, I'm sure. In fact, I was watching somebody's post the other day who was originally from New England and is now further down south and saying how they just can't even stand the cold anymore. And it was like 40 degrees it hit down where they were, saying how they couldn't take it. And I'm thinking, okay, come up here where it's zero again and then go back there and it'll feel warm. In fact, today, yesterday was, I think it was about zero yesterday. And today we went outside and it was almost like you didn't need a coat because it was 40 degrees. Yeah, it's probably 50 now. That was right. So all our snow is melting, which is awesome. Except for it looks messy. So I'm just using half-inch seam allowances is what I use for the majority of my sewing. And that's what I'm using for this project as well. And I love this fabric because nothing is shifting. It's staying exactly where I planned it to stay. And plus my measurements and my seam allowances are accurate too, which is also helpful. If I hadn't done the seam allowances right in my side panels, the top wouldn't fit, you know, because I'd made my measurements for my cuts based on my half inch seam allowance. So that's another thing you want to think about. If you're following somebody else's instruction and you take, whoops, let me get my needle down in there. You use a 5/8 inch seam allowance, which I know some people do that run everything through the serger. Their sergers need that extra little bit. So if you're looking at somebody else's instructions on how to build something and you're using 5/8 inch seam allowances and they're using half inch, you want to make sure that you take that into consideration with your cuts, because even though their instructions are right, you're using different seam allowances, so your measurements are not going to be the same. Hello, Sandra Van Sickle. They're supposed to have 68 degrees on Friday. I think I'm headed your way. That sounds nice. I'm hoping by the time we get to Florida that it's in the 70s. I don't want it too hot, but 70s and sunny would be nice. It's actually sunny here today. We haven't had a lot of sun lately. That's the one thing in the winter that gets depressing, is when you have a lot of gray days on top of the cold. So, due to my consistent seam allowances, my corner is going to be perfect when I end this. There's nothing worse than getting almost finished with a project and getting to the end and realizing it was off. And now you gotta take a whole bunch back out to get back to the point where it went wrong and figure out where that point is. So let me take this out from under the sewing machine, clip my threads. Now, because this is getting upholstered to a frame, I'm not going to serge any of these edges. Obviously, if this was a throw cushion or something, I would do that. But I have a little box over here for my threads. So here we have everything sewn together, our nice square top. Let's turn it right side out and hope that I like the way I decided to lay the fabric patterns out. If I didn't, I can always change it, right? Okay. So all my corners are looking perfect. And I really go over the detail on how to get those exact corners in the video. So there we go. So there is our, let me hold this up so you can see it. There is the top of our cube with our nice bright colorful sides, turning it so you can see the different ones. And you get a green one there, and then down here you got another green one. So now we are ready to go over to the cube and start attaching this. So let me get this shut off. Double check here for questions, although I think Bill's got a handle on the questions. Do I need to look at this anymore, Bill, or are you good? You good? Okay. So I can go ahead and get that out of the way. So now we are at the table with our cube fabric, and let me just get a drink of water because my throat is getting dry here. That's the other thing this time of year. Our house has forced hot air heat, which I love. I love the feeling of the warmth of the air, but it really does dry you out in the winter. So what do you think? Should we put it on? Think it's gonna work? Let's go for it. Just start getting the corners. So what I'm doing first is getting the seams lined up with the corners and then just gently pulling it down a little bit at a time. And she's looking cute. And I think this one's gonna get wheels and be at my sewing machine as well. So I can tell right here, I've got a curl in my dacron. There we go. And the seams are all looking good. I don't see any problems because now's the time to check. You don't wanna be unstapling it to take it off because you missed something. So inspect, inspect. It's kind of like measure twice, cut once. When you get to upholstering something to the frame that you've sewn, you want to check it two or three times before you start upholstering it to the frame, because otherwise it's more work. So why do that? So here you can see, I'm going to spin it so you can see the different sides. So there is the top. I was just looking over there to make sure I had it in a good spot for you guys. And there is the side. Side number one matches side number two. And then these two sides are different. So then here's this one, and you can see I've got a section where the two patterns were kind of mixed together, which was fun. And then over here, this side is a totally different print. It's got the part of what was on this side. It's got the pink and green going on, but more pink than green. So we are ready to start attaching. So I'm going to go ahead and get my staple gun hooked up to my hose. Any questions? Let me see. Jean Billings, hello Jean. She has 70 degrees today, overcast and rain predicted. She's in Nashville, Arkansas, working on two wingback chairs. Fun. Doesn't sound like too bad of weather if it's warm though. Let me see, do I have ammo? I do have ammo. Actually, Bill has long staples in there. Let me switch, because I don't need the 9/16 for what I'm doing. So, all right, so I'm going to start by making sure my corners are lined up. I'm actually going to start on these sides that have the blue. Let me go and flip that because I don't want the blue showing. So I'm going to make sure I get that attached. Feeling my top seams. And I know I've got about, I don't know, 2.5 to 2.75 inches of fabric to pull underneath here. And these, sorry, I mean, your instinct is to kind of watch the patterns of the fabric, but these saris, when the parts were joined together to make this patchwork effect, some of them weren't straight, so I'm kind of not paying attention to those and more going by what I know that I have for distances. And I'm just pulling into the bottom of the frame here. I think that first one I got was a little tight, so I'm probably going to have to shift that. But that is typical. Your first one, you always pull a little bit more aggressively, it seems. And they're loud sometimes. There, so now I am going to go to the opposite side and get a few staples in there. So are any of you going to go ahead and make yourselves some cubes? Fun projects for, I think somebody had mentioned dormitory rooms, which I thought that was a good idea. And then also for kids' rooms too, if you got kids' family room or something. Stapled that one in the wrong place. I'm going to have to take that one staple out and get my pullers. Let's see. So Sandra Van Sickle says she is heading to Atlanta's market for the weekend. Oh, I wish I could come on down. One of these days I am going to get there for the Atlanta market. Don't do that. Go down. I almost ripped the fabric. And that's what happens when you aim your tool. There we go. Towards your finished product instead of away. There we go. ahead and get this staple back on there. So they don't look straight yet, but they will once I get everything attached. So you can see I've just got those two edges attached, and I can tell where my seam allowances for these are ending. Everything's feeling straight. So now I will go ahead and get these other two sides. In fact, I wonder if I could have pulled this one a little tighter. Let me just, no, I think that feels in the same place. All right, now we'll work on this edge. And once it's done, everything will be straight. When you're getting just a few staples in, you end up with some wavy lines. But once you get it all filled in, it should be nice and straight in the end. All right.
I'm going to attempt to play this.
Okay. Bill's going to try to put a little clip of the Qube Ottoman video that we did.
In this video, I'll teach you how to build and upholster your Qube Ottoman.
That's what that is.
We will go over the materials used and how to assemble your Qube.
It's working. There you go. So
I will show you how to pad your Qube using background and foam. I'll also show you the techniques that I use to get perfect corners when sewing your fabric together.
To get a Qube this
your
dimension.
Video comes with a downloadable PDF sizes, outlining just number, fabric yardages, tools we use,
now this one ended up at a 17
inch
height.
Sizes. So get started, and I'll see you
17 and a quarter
on
before I put the wheels
on it.
So once I added the wheels,
how to build
I got it at about 19 inches, which made it perfect for me at my sewing machine. But that, you know, that's for that purpose too. So depending on what you were using it for, if you're using it in your living room and you want to use it to put your feet up on a chair, you might want to sit in the chair, put your feet straight out, and have somebody use a tape measure and see how far off the floor your legs are, and then decide how tall you want your Qubes. And I think without the wheels, they're at a good height for that, in my particular instance. And so the client I did them for, I think hers were a little bit smaller than these, but I wanted them bigger. I get just a couple staples in here, and then I'm going to flip it before I go ahead and fill it in, because we do need to check it just in case. So if I go ahead and stand that up, looking at my stitch line again, I'm not looking at the stitches on the sari. I'm looking at my sewing line to make sure it's where I wanted it, and I think this side needs to be a hair tighter over here. That side's good. Yeah, so I'm going to go ahead and flip it this way so that I can see. I'm going to adjust this side just a smidge tighter. I want that stitch line a little bit further towards the edge than it is. And of course, this is the side I started to put all the staples in, see? And don't stab your hand either when you do this, because that doesn't feel very good. It's one of those things, you first do it, and it doesn't feel that bad when you first do it, but the next day your hand is usually throbbing when you really whack it with these pullers. And of course, this wood really liked my staples. It's snacking on them. Sucked them right in. It was just the outer edges that I needed just a little bit tighter. Ooh, you little bugger. Let me try flipping this. That staple does not want to come out. There we go. And sometimes they do, especially with softer woods, the staples really can sink in. And these aren't sunk quite that bad, but a couple of them were. Right. All one on the corner. One in the middle needs to come out still. And I know you can't see that because it's facing me, but I can just tell I've got a little whoop-de-doo. And in the process of upholstering, you have to pull staples. It's just the way it works. People get frustrated because they feel like they're pulling as many staples during the process as you pull when you're tearing down a piece of furniture. But sometimes you need to make adjustments, you know. It's just, you think about when you're sewing something and you take out some threads to make an adjustment, it's the same type of thing. So there, that's better. All right, so I'm liking the way that's looking. Everything's looking nice. Pattern's flowing well. So I'm ready to go ahead and fill it in with a little more staples and then put the dust cover on. That side's actually pretty good. And you always want to check before you go and really fill it in, because why take out that many more staples if you don't have to, if you're going to make an adjustment? And you can see how everything is straightening out. And I'm not talking while I'm stapling because I know you can't hear me anyway. There. So now I have all four sides totally secured down. I've got my corners folded nice. I'm going to go ahead and trim some of this excess off, and then we'll put our dust cover and our little glides off. On, rather, not off. Now the glides make it easy to slide across the floor if you're not using wheels or anything like that. You could also screw in legs on this. You could get some decorative legs and little bun feet or something. So there's a gazillion things you could do to make this fit the style of your room other than just changing the fabric. And I figured in my sewing room, I wanted something exciting and fun and energizing. Get you in the mood when you're having one of those days where you're having troubles getting going on work or something. You get happy stuff to cheer you up. We got some snafus going on, Bill said, so we apologize for the issues.
Almost sounds like we have double sound on Facebook, but I can't really tell you.
So on Facebook, are you having troubles with the sound there? Bill says it almost sounds like there's a double sound, like you're hearing me twice. It means I have to talk twice as fast now. Anybody commenting on the sound?
Talk slower.
Talk slower? All right, so we have everything stapled. I've gone ahead and I've trimmed it all down so you can see all that. And now what I'm going to do is put my cambric on this. Hey, secret storage. I need one more staple right here, I can see. There it is. All right, so what I use for a dust cover is called cambric or black accord. And it's just, dust covers really are made just to kind of like close everything up and make it look nice and neat. I think in the old days, dust covers actually caught the dust from like the straw and stuff that they used. And the modern techniques, you don't need that and need to use that. You use cottons and the dacrons and the foam so you don't have that fiber coming down. But we still use dust covers to make it look good. So let's go ahead and get that on here. So Maria, hello Maria. She says she loves the fabric. What fabric is that? This is a recycled sari. So this is a piece of a fabric that I bought at Brimfield Flea Market. And they are recycled saris made into throws, and then I am making them into upholstery. And they did have one booth at Brimfield that was all chairs done with saris. And I just fell in love with that booth because it was so colorful. So I just folded the edges over here, so when I have it, whoops, did that staple go right through? It did. Back off, Kim. There we go. If you're working on a situation, your staple goes right through your fabric and cuts it, you're either putting too much pressure on the gun itself or your pressure's set too high sometimes. But for me, I know it's that I'm using soft lumber. So I just back the staple gun off the fabric and that solves the problem. All right. And I'll add more staples too once I get this all in position. You don't need a ton of staples in your dust cover. You just need enough to get it to lay flat. So if you're using you're working on a chair frame that's got a curved bottom, you need more than you would on a chair frame that's got a straight bottom. And when you do that the first time and walk away from the chair and see this little whoop-de-doo of black fabric, you'll know exactly what I'm talking about. Trim this down because I don't need that much to fold under. My nice corners. Corner one, corner two. That means we're almost done, right? Second corner. So this is definitely a project you can do in a day. So we started, whoops, I went too hard with the staple gun there. So we started at 12:30 with the sewing and attaching it to the frame, and we're going to be done in an hour, and that would be sewing and upholstering. So that's real time, obviously. And then last week, in an hour's time, we padded our frame and got all our fabric cut out, and then we didn't put the lumber part together live on camera, but I don't think that took more than an hour to do that. So there's 3 hours of time plus cutting your lumber, which obviously we did off camera because those would be really noisy. So you definitely could do this in an afternoon and have it ready for the party by the time everybody comes, right? So invite me, I want to sit on your cube. Okay. Looks like I'm probably going to want another staple or two over on that side, I can tell already. Spin it around. And I can see one there. All right, now the next step is to put on my plastic glides, which I can't get close enough to that camera, but I did show you these the other week, I think. These are little... Can they even see that, Bill? These are little plastic, hard plastic discs. They're probably, I don't know, halfway between the size of a nickel and a quarter. And then they've got a nail coming out of them. And you just nail them into the bottom of your frame. And don't throw them on the floor. And don't step on them. I did that the other day. Dropped one on the floor. Luckily, I had on thick sole shoes and stepped on one of these babies. That would not have felt good if I hadn't had those particular shoes. But anyway, so then you take a hammer and you hammer it into the bottom of your frame. So that way when you're sitting this on your carpet or your hardwood floor, it doesn't scratch. It slides really easily. So I'm going to use a wooden mallet to do that. My wooden mallet is in desperate need of new fabric. So I'm going to put them in the corners. Kind of get it started by hand. And then tap it down. Sometimes they do break. It happens. So you notice I got 5 out, because if I had gotten just 4 out to do this live, I would have definitely broken one, and we're not done yet, so that could happen. I could break 2 and wish I had gotten 6, right? Murphy's not here today, so we're gonna hope Murphy stays away. fingers crossed, two more to go. So far, so good. I'm putting that off to the side. I just jinxed myself, right? Ta-da! All four of them, not one broke. Woohoo! Now let's flip this baby over. Get my junk out of the way here in the trash can. And I'm gonna try to pick that other one up and sit it up here and show you with the wheels the difference in the height. So here is our fun completed cube. And I don't know about you, but I'm liking these combinations of fabrics. And there's the one that I wanted to add to get those flowers in there. So there's cube number one with just, or cube number two actually, with just the glides. And they're not heavy, they're just awkward to hang on to. So there you can see by just adding those wheels, I gave myself a little bit of extra height, which works perfect at my sewing machine. So let me measure and so you can see exactly how much extra this added. So that measures about 19 3/4, and this measures 17 3/4. So those wheels gave me the extra 2 inches that I needed to be able to sit at the sewing machine and sew comfortably for height. So for you, it might be higher, it might be lower. What, Bill?
I'm going to see if I can put up that video of what we'll be doing next week, right? Hopefully.
Okay. So I need your help on this one. Bill's going to put up a video of what we're going to be doing next week, and I think he's winning with his fabric choice, but I was really hoping I'd win with mine. So go ahead and watch this video and let me know what your thought is, and you'll see my question at the end of the video.
So my question hear the sound, Bill? You and the help that I need is what to do this chair in. I do have some brown leather, so I could do it in a brown leather again, or I could turn it over to the Kim side and make it into my signature pink sort of colors. So let me know in the feed below, what do you think, pink or leather? Hi, it's Kim. I wanted to give you a peek at a project that we're going to be doing live on Facebook. This is an antique office chair that we purchased a few years ago in Asheville, North Carolina, when we were down there doing the sewing and upholstery retreat. This chair is currently done in a brown leather, and as you can see, it's torn and tattered here and there. The wood also needs some cleanup and some repair, and we need to clean up the metal mechanisms as well. So let me spin it around, show you the back. Here you can see on the outside back, it's got the decorative tacks, which I hope to redo and do decorative tacks again. So my question for you and the help that I need is what to do this chair in. I do have some brown leather, so I could do it in a brown leather again, or I could turn it over to the Kim side and make it into my signature pink sort of colors. So let me know in the feed below, what do you think, pink or leather? Hi, it's Kim. I wanted to give you a peek at a project.
So you get to watch that little video there of the chair that we're going to be doing next week. And we have had that chair sitting around for just over 2 years now, and it is time to put it into use and get it done. Bill has cleaned up all the wood on it, and he's gotten the mechanisms, the metal mechanisms, so it is adjustable to height. So it'll either be at my sewing machine or at his desk. I think it's probably too petite a chair for him to have at his desk, so I will probably end up with it. But he would like to see it done in the brown leather, and of course, you know what I want to do it in. So give me your vote and let me know what your thoughts are, but I do think he's probably going to win this time. And that chair, I think we paid, $38 for or something? It was really inexpensive, and we did a little bit of research and found out, what's the name of the company, do you remember?
Gunlock. It's a
gunlock chair from a company that's been in business since the early 1900s, and it looks like ours is somewhere between 1920 and 1940 that this chair is from, so we're excited to get that done. So if you are interested in making Qube Ottomans for yourself, I encourage you to hop on over to Kim's Upholstery right now and check out the Qube Ottoman video. It's part of your membership for those of you that are already members, but it's also for sale as an individual video. So check it out and stop back here next Wednesday at 12:30 Eastern Standard Time, and let's see what we're going to put on that antique chair. Thanks for joining us, and I hope you have a great day. Bye-bye. Now to get my wheels.